Greek and Roman mythology is full of stories about exotic islands that were home to weird and fearsome monsters, like one-eyed ogres, seductive sirens, and man-eating giants. And I'm here to tell you, back in the late Miocene epoch, there was in fact an island, or maybe a group of islands, in the Mediterranean Sea that was populated with fantastic giant beasts. But these giants were actually pretty small. Some of them you might even consider cute. There were enormous hamsters and big fat water birds that could neither fly nor swim, and hedgehog-like animals that were as big as house cats. These organisms were only giants compared to their ancestors, which had lived on the European mainland. But once they became isolated on these Mediterranean islands, some of these little critters attained massive body sizes. That's because geographic isolation is a powerful force in evolution. Sometimes, when a population of animals gets cut off from many of its normal predators or competitors, it gives rise to new species of unusual sizes. Sometimes they turn out to be miniaturized versions of their ancestors, other times giants. The tale of these Mediterranean island beasts of the Miocene is no myth. It's a lesson in the very strange but very real powers of natural selection. In 1969, a group of Dutch paleontologists were working in Gargano, a region on the eastern coast of Italy, when they discovered deep fissures or cracks in the limestone quarries and road cuts there. And these cracks turned out to be full of fossils. For millions of years, it seemed animals had been stumbling into these fissures, like natural traps, starting about 8 million years ago. The result was an amazingly rich fossil deposit, a snapshot of life in this place in the late Miocene epoch. But a few things about the Gargano fossils turned out to be really odd. For one thing, scientists were confused about the fossils they didn't find. Elsewhere in Europe, deposits from the late Miocene tend to contain a lot of large mammals, like extinct elephants, cats, and perissodactyls, a group of hoofed animals that include horses. But at Gargano, none of those animals were anywhere to be found. Instead, researchers uncovered an eclectic and bizarre bestiary, including fossils of smaller animals that seemed overgrown. There were extra-large owls, alarmingly big hamsters, and supersized hedgehogs. This strange assortment of animals came to be known as the Microtia fauna. And for decades, the Gargano Peninsula, along with a handful of nearby towns, were the only places on the planet where these creatures were known. Then in the 1990s, fossils of some of those same peculiar animals turned up at Miocene sites near Scontrone, a town in central Italy. So what exactly were these animals? Why were the Miocene animals of Gargano and Scontrone so different from their counterparts in the rest of Europe? For paleontologists, the most likely explanation was that these areas must have been cut off, geographically separated from the rest of Europe. Specifically, they were probably islands, or maybe parts of the same island. This would explain not only why these animals appeared just at those sites, it would also account for the strange body sizes of animals that were ordinarily quite small. I've talked before about how in island environments, large body animals can often get smaller over time. For example, in the case of Colombian mammoths on the Channel Islands of California, the absence of large predators combined with limited food led natural selection to favor smaller body sizes. So after thousands of years, some of the giant Colombian mammoths had developed into what scientists consider a new, separate, and smaller species, the pygmy mammoth. This phenomenon is known as insular dwarfism, but it's only part of the story about how island environments can tinker with animals' body plans. The flip side is what happened to some of the animals on Gargano and Scontrone, insular gigantism. Both processes are part of what's known as Foster's Rule, identified by biologist J. Bristol Foster in 1964. Essentially, Foster's Rule says that in isolated environments, large animals frequently get smaller, and tiny animals often become larger. And this is what happened to many animals in the Microtia fauna, and it happened because their habitat allowed it to happen. Much like the modern Channel Islands, the regions of Gargano and Scontrone in the deep past were higher in elevation than the surrounding areas. So as sea levels rose and fell over millions of years due to changes in climate, these places became isolated from the rest of Europe and then reconnected many times. And it may have been during one of these periods of low sea levels when some ancestors of the island giants first made their way to Gargano and Scontrone. Researchers think that about 30 million years ago in the Oligocene epoch, a global cooling trend lowered sea levels in the Mediterranean and elsewhere, forming a land bridge between the mainland and these two spots. But then, about 15 million years ago, the climate warmed again and sea levels rose, turning those high spots into islands and severing their connection to the mainland. So maybe the ancestors of the Macrotia fauna simply walked across the land bridge before it became submerged. But other scientists have proposed that most of them arrived much more recently, just around 8 million years ago, when the island or islands were properly isolated. In that case, it's thought that the animals might have rafted on piles of floating debris, like logs, branches, and palm leaves, much in the same way that the ancestors of South America's rodents are thought to have migrated from Africa. Either way, once they reached their new island habitats, many of these animals started to follow different evolutionary paths. Some stayed small, and some may have actually shrunk, but others responded to their new environments by getting downright huge. Just look at Dinogalarix, a shrew-like member of the hedgehog family that's found only in these Macrotia fossil deposits. Early species of this genus were about 30 to 45 centimeters long, making them only slightly bigger than a modern European hedgehog. But over time, bigger and badder Dinogalarix started to evolve alongside them. The largest species, found only in the most recent deposits, was some 60 centimeters long. And even though it was a member of the hedgehog family, Dinogalarix had teeth that were more like those of cats and dogs. Using its long, pointy incisors and crushing cheek teeth, the largest of this genus probably behaved like a badger or raccoon, hunting much larger prey than its ancestors ever could. And it did, simply because it could. Back on the mainland, the ancestors of Dinogalarix needed to stay small in order to avoid all of the large predators. But in this island environment, there were very few large terrestrial carnivores. So without the selective pressure to remain small, Dinogalarix was free to expand in size and take advantage of new niches. Its ancestors probably specialized in eating insects, but this animal could have hunted other larger prey, like vertebrates. In the process, it emerged as one of the area's biggest land-dwelling hunters. This was Foster's rule in action. But a big old hedgehog-like thing still had some competitors and natural enemies, because these islands were also home to some unusually large birds of prey. Take the giant owl known as Taito gigantea, which appeared on Gargano in the late Miocene. We don't know for sure which species it evolved from, but we do know that there was nothing near its size on the mainland. Based on its fossils, scientists think that Taito gigantea may have had a wingspan of 2 meters or more, twice the size of a living barn owl. Likewise, the islands were also home to a bird of prey known as Gargano aetis, which included two species. The larger one probably rivaled today's golden eagle in size, and it's only found in more recent deposits. So this suggests that Gargano aetis, like the giant owl, developed a bigger body size over time. But here's a question. On an island with few other predators, why would these birds of prey get so large? Wouldn't it just mean that they needed to eat more food? Well, some researchers think that on these islands of giants, both predators and prey were engaged in a sort of evolutionary arms race. Research has shown that the modern barn owl can't swallow any rodents whose heads are larger than 17 millimeters. But by being bigger, these birds would have had an easier time hunting and gulping down the local rodents, which were also getting quite hefty. For example, there's the burrowing rodent Macrotia, the Gargano native that gave this whole group its name. One species of Macrotia had a skull that was twice the size of a modern rat's head, suggesting the rest of the animal was pretty big too. There was also a giant species of dormouse, which are usually tiny and adorable, but this one weighed about a kilogram, which, you know, still sounds pretty cute to me. And then there was Gargano's strange giant hamster, Hattomys gargantua. It was 3 times heavier than today's common hamster and much bigger than any species that lived on the mainland at this time. Mind you, not all of these island animals expanded in size over time. Small and normal-sized birds and rodents coexisted with giant species. But some rodents definitely got bigger, either because they simply could or because it let them expand into new dietary niches. And as they grew, the birds of prey also evolved larger sizes in order to hunt and eat them. This same phenomenon occurred among other kinds of birds too. Take the case of Garganornis, first reported in 2013. Garganornis belonged to the same family of birds as ducks and geese, but it weighed between 15 and 22 kilograms, up to twice as much as a large Canada goose. Unlike modern geese and ducks, its toes and lower leg bones were really short, suggesting that it spent most of its time walking on land and not paddling in the water. And judging by its bones and its wings, it probably couldn't fly either. So researchers think that Garganornis adapted to take advantage of its island's lack of big herbivorous mammals. By growing bigger and staying on land, it may have been able to broaden its niche and forage on a wider range of terrestrial plants, while its size could have helped it fend off some of those birds of prey. And size adaptations seem to have benefited some larger mammals on the island too. One herbivore known exclusively from Microtia deposits was the truly strange Hoplitomyrix, a genus of hoofed mammal with saber-like fangs and five horns on their heads. Five. And there were lots of different species of this so-called prong deer that varied a lot in size. By one estimate, the smallest only weighed around 5 to 6 kilograms, while the biggest may have tipped the scales at 113 kilograms. And species of different sizes seem to have lived at the same time, which kind of makes sense. Different sizes would make different food sources available to each species. This would have not only kept the prong deer from competing with each other, it could have also prevented them from overgrazing their little island. But there was a change on the horizon that none of the weird and beautiful Microtia fauna could adapt their way out of. About 5.3 million years ago, a massive amount of Atlantic water passed through the Strait of Gibraltar, which had once been lifted above sea level. This flooded the Mediterranean. Rising water levels dramatically shrank the little giant's island habitat, which is probably what drove them to extinction. Just a few million years later, in the early Pleistocene, some areas of central and southern Italy went through a period of tectonic uplift. That reunited Gargano and Scontrone with the rest of the mainland where they remain today. So competition, food availability, predator-prey relationships, and niche expansion. Any or all of these things can, very gradually, make either pygmies or giants out of animals that are isolated on islands. It's not mythology, it's natural history, and we have their fascinating fossil remains to remind us of the odd little giants that once roamed these ancient Mediterranean islands. Thanks for watching. We want to let you know about a new show from PBS Digital Studios. Soundfield is a new music education show that explores the music theory, production, history, and culture behind our favorite songs and musical styles. Pop, classical, rap, jazz, electronic, folk, country, and more. Soundfield covers it all. Hosted by two supremely talented musicians, Arthur L.A. Buckner and Nari Soul, every episode is one part video essay and one part musical performance. So go subscribe to Soundfield, link in the description below. Thanks for joining me today in the newly named Constantine Hasa Studio, and an extra big thanks to our current eontologists, Jake Hart, John Ivy, John Davison Ng, and Steve. If you'd like to join them and our other patrons in supporting what we do here, then go to patreon.com/eons and make your pledge. Now, what do you want to learn about? Leave us a comment and don't forget to go to youtube.com/eons and subscribe.